мы с вами начали заниматься такой трудной темой, о которой сейчас только и знают, что говорят. Я уже сообщал вам, что 10-й Всемирный Русский Народный Собор...
We've started to consider such a difficult problem that stands high in people's discussions. I've informed you that the 10th World Russian People's Council is devoted to this very problem, problem of freedom and human rights.
Когда парламентская ассамблея Совета Европы постановила о том, что религиозные...
Parliamentary Assembly of the Council of Europe declared that religious rights are subordinate to human rights. Do you realize how serious this fact is and what it could result in? Women can demand holy orders, otherwise they might call it infringement on their rights. The so-called minorities will demand church recognition, and not only a public recognition. The church that would not agree to it will find itself to be out of law, as was the case in ancient Rome. Christianity was the religio illicita, illegal religion. And now, if the church that doesn't recognize it as the proper order of things, as a norm of human life, and will condemn it, will find itself outlawed. So the process is going on in one direction, and it is quite obvious. It is going along the route, maybe not in form, as the essence lies not in the form, but in its ideological contents, that has been tied up long with masonry fundamentals.
Необходимо проводить в жизнь следующий принцип: разнуздать, чтобы взнуздать.
Underlying the principle to unbridle in order to bridle. That principle is strikingly strong, and it is being enforced into life with strong determination and sequence of so-called enlightened society, that is, European and American ones. And now it will be carried out in this country as there are no more ideological boundaries. So I have already told you, if we consider freedom and human rights idealistically, that will sound fine and clear-cut, to give freedom to every person. But on the other hand, realize as any right is two-sided, it can be used as anyone might wish to. In the same way, freedom, one would do what he wants. For one, freedom of speech, it may be used as being able to publish not only obscene words, but long, unquotable speeches, insulting, lewd, that is evident. Secondly, what should be borne in mind, if we understand this freedom, irrespective of a particular person, what all that could result in? Every person is in a certain moral spiritual condition. The question arises immediately. Could the same equal rights be given both to a highly morally motivated and law-obedient man and to a criminal? Just please try and give the same freedoms which are granted to the law-obedient people and to the criminal society. What would come out of any society, any state? These are the two things that strike the eye when we hear all this noise and these cries about freedoms and freedoms and freedoms.
И, наконец, последнее, что нужно сказать, что все те юридические свободы, которые даются законом, так они...
And finally, legal freedoms, which are given by law, the most possible thing they could do is to detain from the most vicious crimes, damaging human's bodies, basically.
В основном касающихся телесной жизни человека. тело его. Вот. Только здесь свободы устанавливают некие ограничения. Но самое
In this case only freedoms impose some limits. But the most important and significant things lie in the fact that legal freedoms do not contain the major thing from the Christian point of view. They do not target human being at spiritual freedom, at acquisition of spiritual freedom. They do not do anything in this aspect. Do you remember we talked about three types of freedom? All these outward rights and freedoms do not direct, do not stimulate, do not call for spiritual freedom. In other words, they imply I might act in whichever way I want to, though it will affect detrimentally the other people. So I would like to say that one of the mistakes, or rather one of the insidious things that are hidden in that propaganda of freedom, lie in the fact that when they speak about prohibitions, they refer really to the life of a body only. Spiritual and moral aspects are not taken into account. Just realize what is behind it. Make it a point. In front of these facts, a man is considered to be not more than an animal. The concern is only about a body, about its rights, tied up with biological, intelligent, aesthetic needs. That is to say, about purely materially based interests. And nothing else. It is saturated with materialism, with deepest materialism and atheism. God is not mentioned at all. They do not mean the spiritual side of a human being, not in the least. Suffice is to look at those moral perversions which are being advocated, or at some things which should be hidden from open public being naturally, in order to understand and to make sure of that. Spiritual side of a man, that is what makes a man a human being, and that is the only thing that makes him a human being in its essence, is not taken into account. And I would say it is simply ignored. A man is considered almost as an animal. Here where the root lies, here where the main trouble is, that is enclosed in that very subject matter, in the way it is being viewed by the modern world. Подвержено влиянию греха и страстей, видите, говорит о духовной стороне человека. I cited the quotation from Saint Ignatius Brenchinin, who evaluated the possibility of achieving these freedoms. He writes, as long as the mankind is subordinate to the influence of a thing or passions, you see that he speaks about a spiritual side of a man. Power and subordination are needed. They are sure to exist as long as the world lives, but they may appear now and will appear in different forms. And then he says, neither equality, nor perfect freedoms, nor prosperity on the earth can exist on earth in that very measure as they wish to. And what is being promised by excited false teachers? Relationship between power and subordination will be destroyed only when the world is destroyed. Then authority and power will come to an end. Then brotherhood, equality and freedom will be established. Do you remember the main motto of the French Revolution, brotherhood, equality, freedom? How easily people can be allured by these empty words, which mean, in fact, quite the opposite. Then the reason for the power and subordination unity will be love, not fear. You see how from the above said we can understand What is the principal position of Christianity relative to the rights and freedoms? How can these rights, freedoms, be considered as some external conditions only that must help a man not only to preserve his or her humanity, but as far as it is possible to elevate this humanity? As soon as freedoms act into their opposite, they become evil, not good. In moral aspect, we'll all become witnesses of these things. What basic principle should be laid in functioning or fulfilling these rights and freedoms that the world speaks about? We Christians do not deny the right of a person of freedom of speech, freedom of press, freedom of belief. We do not deny, not in the least. These are natural things, like it is natural for a person to be hungry, to be thirsty, and etc. But what should be laid in the foundation of these rights? As all human rights concern not a single person, but the whole society, because we all live in a society, not in a forest. We all influence each other. We can influence anyway. And we influence not only externally when we are in contact with each other, but spiritually. We influence spiritually because spiritual influence, this is the reality, and we cannot depart from it. We know that in each society, state, family, even in each book, there is its spirit and spiritual influence, to say nothing about the moral one, which is quite obvious. So spiritual influence is always present. That is why it is very important to see what lies in the root, in the very basis of these rights and freedoms, which are we speaking about. What is the main thing here? I believe what is the most important here, my friends, is to emphasize one notion that should be borne in mind, and I would like to draw your attention to that. What do you think should be the major principle in all our inter-humankind relations, and in that very problem of freedom and human rights? Fear of love. What is fear of love? You know, doctors take the oath of Hippocrates, do not do any harm, fear not to harm. What is the fear of that? Fear of love towards a person. A doctor should make everything possible to cure a person. True, save him from death, not to make him get the infection. It is a fear to do a person a lot of harm. On the contrary, we are to save him as far as we can from the real and possible harm. Fear of love. Here is the basic principle of Christian understanding of what rights and freedoms mean. Fear of love, that is the main thing, not to harm. Even the venerable Versinophius the Great said, good is the freedom tied up with fear of God. What is with fear of God? What is the fear of God? We often speak about that. That is not a fair affront of God as before a monster that can swallow if you did anything wrong. Nothing of the kind. God is love, invariable love. That is the fear to insult God loves, and we should not understand it like God perhaps loves me somehow and I'm afraid to insult him. Not that. God is inside a man. Kingdom of God is within us, tells us the gospel. God is and is called the nature of all that exists and our nature as well. Not in essence, but in its energy. This thought belongs to Gregory Palama. So when we speak about a fear of love, we mean how not to do harm by our behavior, by our freedom. Do you hear? By our freedom, by our rights. Fear is a very good word when we have the fear of insulting a dearest beloved man. We are afraid to insult the person who saved our life, maybe saved you from great sufferings and misfortunes. So constantly helps us in our life. We are afraid to insult because of love and gratitude to him. So it turns out that the basic principle of Christian life lies in love. And here, when we speak about behavioral side of a man and rights and freedoms are behavioral side of a human being, here the basic principle should be the fear of love. Unfortunately, this humanitarian morale does not know it at all. This is a real evil. A man is God the man. Look what a great motto that seems to be. But in real fact, I am God. Egocentrism is striking. Pride meets pride, measuring themselves. Who is most pride? Do not touch me, and I will not touch you. And you touch me, then you will know. Here is what the competition occurs. So you see, the Venerable Varsanofius said, good is the freedom connected with the fear of God. If freedom is not connected with the fear of God, so you may say, right away, my friends, it becomes murderous for a man and a society. It results in the most negative consequences, most negative, and in moral degradation above all. I am free, and I behave how I want to, and we see it practically everywhere. I notice it everywhere. One lady called me yesterday and said, my husband and wife went to Romania. We thought to have a vacation for 2 weeks. These are Christians. So we couldn't stay on the beach, just could not. We could not watch what was going on there. We just used to get up and leave. We returned not being refreshed, but very exhausted. So I listened to the story over the telephone and recalled the story about Lot, when angels came to him, and how Lot suffered from that nightmare that surrounded him from everywhere. I believe that many people nowadays begin to suffer from this and will suffer even more from this lack of all this strain, from all these ugliest things, which increase greatly more and more in their scale. This leads to anarchism, to anti-culture, and better to say, to complete unscrupulousness and violation of sacred things and purity that exist in a man. Unfortunately, the world doesn't ask Christianity how it evaluates all this. And here I've made a note from Solzhenitsyn's works. Once he wrote, I've carried away by the ideas of freedom, but we forgot that the wisest measurements of freedom are the far-sighted self-restrictions. By the way, you know, at first he was welcomed in the West, in the United States, with much enthusiasm because he criticized what we have here. Then he started to propagate the same ideas against that kind of freedom that is in their country. And immediately he became not good at all. The criticism against him started. By the way, these are elementary things that any reasonable person knows. No special knowledge of Christianity is needed. The very nature of a man calls it. For example, Epictetus, an ancient philosopher, wrote, he who is free in body and not free in soul, he is a slave. And accordingly, he who is tied up in the body and is free spiritually is free. Think, Roman Stoics understood it.
Они это понимали. Да и что ж тут понимать? Сейчас идет какое-то странное...
Now what is happening is a strange humiliation of a man. Striking humiliation. A man is more often turned into a two-legged beast. Evidently, they want to see a man just like this. The reason for this is quite obvious. Because of this moral anarchism, which is being stepped up harder and harder, may will start screaming and crying. We need strong power, iron hand. What is needed is despotism. And some people keep saying now, what bad luck, Stalin is needed. Well, so little blood was shed, another Stalin is needed. So the call of the world is, where are you, a strong arm that will rule upon us? Do you see what is the whole thing driven to? A person will be welcomed, the very person who will turn to be such an arm and set everything in order, an order which has never existed in the history. He will set an order, death penalties, killings, destruction of billions, not millions of people, and the remaining will clap their hands, not understanding that tomorrow they will be sent in the same direction. And everything is going right in this way. This anarchy is like a string. Stretch a string, it will try to shrink backwards as you squeeze it. It will try and stretch. And this keeps going on, like in history. As you have noticed, strings squeeze, and then revolutionary everything is broken into pieces. They are stretched and then squeezed back into despotism. So we are marching in this way. A horrible despotism, then a striking so-called freedom. And so it goes on, this historic game during the whole life of mankind. People cannot find where is the golden middle. When nothing is stretched and nothing is squeezed. Christianity? No. They do not. So they do not and cannot understand it. That is what it results in on ideological level. Christianity says straightforward, everything is permissible for me, but not everything is beneficial, writes Apostle Paul. Everything is permissible for me, but I will not be mastered by anything. Apostle Peter, condemning this modern, we all think that those ancient times advocates of freedom are mad. No. Modern ones, listen how clearly he wrote, referring just to our times. For the mouth empty, boastful words, and by appealing to the lustful desires of sinful human nature, the enters people who are just escaping from those who live in error. They promise them freedom, while they themselves are slaves of depravity. For a man is a slave to whatever has mastered him. Being slaves, they promise freedom. In Epistle to Galatians, Apostle Paul writes, you, my brothers, were called to be free, but do not use your freedom to indulge the sinful nature. Rather, serve one another in love. So I say, live by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the sinful nature. So the sinful nature desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the sinful nature. Then he cites the deeds of flesh and concludes unambiguously, do not be deceived. God cannot be mocked. A man reaps what he sows. The one who sows to please the sinful nature from that nature will reap destruction, a smoldering. The one who sows to please the Spirit will reap eternal life. Smoldering is destruction. Everything will be burnt out. Spirit is not subjected to the power of fire. How all this is clear and authentic, I believe, there is no doubt. Let's consider, for example, freedom of telecommunication. In one of the papers, it was called television plague of violence. In other paper, people who sit spending a lot of time in front of television are called tele-idiots. Why idiots? You know what idiotism is characterized by? Everything that an idiot has at hand, he will try to swallow. Nuts, nails, glass, bread, sausage. It doesn't really matter that he doesn't understand. He is ready to chew and swallow everything. So, like a man who has got this freedom, keeps sitting in front of the television, becomes numb for hours and swallows everything. In fact, tele-idiot. This is a new type of illness that sprang up in the 20th century. So, a television plague of violence. I once read how American psychologists evaluated the status of television in this country in this way. When you switch on the television, you automatically switch off in yourself the process of formation of a person. Very strong words. Do you know where is the temptation of television? It's in the fact that alongside really positive things, say information about the latest events, or if you watch in the world of animals, you will hardly tear away from the screen, so exciting it is. But the whole problem is in the fact that if a man, having access to everything, cannot limit himself by watching the most needed, he will, of course, touch the screen by his left heel, and there behind this button there is something else unpredicted. At least God does not know what is there, because God doesn't want this kind of things. The same American psychologist cites an example which some time ago was fit for the United States, and now it absolutely fits for our country. He writes that by the age of 18, a man will have watched about 150,000 crimes. Out of these, 25,000 are murders. Just imagine that a murder occurred before our eyes. What a stress in our condition will be. What a horrible thing. And when you watch on the big screen, and what murders? 25,000 murders. What television is fulfilled with? And as soon as they start showing this, love, sexual scenes, they will definitely be accompanied with criminal acts, murders, etc. Really, passions are interconnected. They are related souls.
Приходится часто приводить пример, но это неплохо, что часто.
I often cite an example that I believe it must be kept in one's memory and help us in all of things. The point is that a man possesses not a consciousness, but he possesses a striking depth, unlimited depth of subconsciousness. All information which is obtained during his lifetime, all from outside and inside, from all scenes, passes into his subconsciousness, not only from five senses, that is outside information, but all from thoughts, desires, emotional experience, and etc. All. Nothing disappears. This subconsciousness, this is that memory which had no limit, infinite volume of memory. Moreover, some people consider, and there are grounds for this, scientific basis, that a genetic memory exists. They assert that our subconsciousness keeps not only the data that we personally acquire, but most probably, and I repeat, there are confirmation by facts.
Я говорю еще раз, к этому есть определенные фактические подтверждения. Очень вероятно, хранится даже и тот
that it keeps a certain balance, a certain information that was obtained by our predecessors. Predecessors, and it goes far back as Adam. The levels, though, are quite different. For example, psychology accounts 10th level of subconsciousness. I believe it's something outdated. 10th in the 10th power. This I will accept, but 10 levels, this is nonsense. Genetic memory is a very serious thing, which is confirmed, do you know by what? By a notion of generation sin. So, that is to say, by effect of previous spiritual and moral condition of preceding fathers, grandfathers, and etc. Previous generations, their influence on this very man. In this aspect, we are born not free. We are born not like Jean-Jacques Rousseau thought. He asserted that a person is a plain board, tabula rasa, on which social environment, parents, school, upbringing write something. No, it's not the fact. No. Psychology and history, elementary observation, testify how serious our behavior is stipulated by what was present in our predecessors. Sometimes we are amazed even how a son resembles his father or grandfather. Sometimes a lot of their very particular features of the characters are alike. We notice it in their outside behavior part, but we do not see far more serious part, spiritual side of their nature. So it turns out that this information, or it's better to say what a person has come through in his life, what happened in the past in his predecessor's life, nothing has disappeared. This is all passed over, is transferred to, everything is written down, so to say, in the genes, everything. And each subsequent generation will get everything from the previous one. Everything is recorded, everything is passed to. The whole thing is in the fact, in what measure it will affect me and to which tribes. Here, the Bible observation, as you remember, for example, those evil criminal actions. Do you remember? Through to the fourth tribe. The Bible says, God punishes through to the fourth tribe. That is just the form of expressing an idea. In real fact, what does it mean, punishes? That is, a man can suffer, experience, and spiritual illnesses that are born together with him, which are inherited by him from his fathers. To understand the point, through the fourth tribe, it evidently tells on him very obviously. At the same time, it says about another side, till 1,000 of generation. Do you remember? It is said about those who did good things. It so happens that positive things surpass all negative sinful sides many times. Infinitely, facts taken from alive, facts of observation, testify directly. That is a hard fact, something quite obvious. We've heard in the countryside, perhaps less in towns, that parents consider carefully is what family a daughter could be given to when she is married, from which family a bride might be found. They investigated it thoroughly, and in a family when a great grandfather killed a man or was a thief or a drunkard, did it really matter? Did it have anything to do with present marriage? They looked so carefully. People who were not educated, who had no this superficial education, they were so wise. they assessed a man so shrewdly. So, as you see, this freedom of information, freedom of teleinformation, what it makes, it hits directly all human senses, soul, intellect, and spirit. And this it saturates our subconsciousness with great amount of filth. I'm to cite an example here. Imagine what would happen if we open a cellar and before some carrion had been placed. We wouldn't be able to stay in this room, despite the fact that everything around us was perfect and shiny. Or if you lay a table with all kind of tasty things and food, and from under it a smell of a dead body. With what appetite will you bite these delicious things, sensing this awful smell? Can you realize now that a cellar is subconsciousness? It is present in each person. That should be borne in mind. Everything that is being actively perceived by us imposes a great effect. It really means a lot. What we are inclined at and what we are filled with. So that is why St. Father speaks about the importance of a struggle with passions. So we spoke about means really. You may not fight passions and keep adding more and more to the self. The more stench it will accumulate, God establishes a commandment. Take care. Do not do harm to yourself. St. Fathers describe it right in the same way. Rooting steps of spiritual life. Do not make harm to yourself. Why do we speak about that? Because they love like parents, love their children, and want to bar us from sufferings. They warn them, they protect them, they guard them in the same way God protects us with His commandments. So we speak about freedom of television, radio, films, and press. What is it associated with? If there is no fear of love there, that is a disaster for mankind. A fear of love only can detain. Not for anything in the world. I will show it to them. What are you doing? Have you gone mad? What will happen with people in reality? These nasty films, commercials, and etc. These are the ideas of liberation. But from what? This is instant, most brute interest. Where does it come from? Who needs it? Devil only. Consequently, who rules the process? Satanists. It arises, no doubt at all. So Sergius cites an interesting example, a very graphic example from the life of the US. It took place in New York in 1978. Just that was a quite an ordinary state of things. They cut off an electric power in this giant megalopolis for 3 hours. What has started, he says. They started to break windows in shops, rob supermarkets, steal things from one another. He says, whole nightmare began for 3 hours. An incredible brigand that swept the city, New York. And he dwells on a similar occasion. 40 years from now, before the World War II, everything was just the other way around. People helped each other, lit candles, distributed them, tried to pull those stuck in elevators, and so on. What has occurred over these past 40 years in the USA? By the way, this should be borne in mind. How much America has changed. It was a rather Puritan country. The World War II has changed the world catastrophically. It has turned it upside down. It has literally corrupted it. In this given case, America is quite a vivid example. Solzhenitsyn points to that example and says, 40 years have passed. Look what has happened. in the same New York, the same event, but people behave in quite the opposite way. What people? Those people who had received a complete freedom. What I want, I will do. Instincts are restrained by law only. These destructive, murderous acts, they're afraid of the law only. As soon as an opportunity sprung up to behave avoiding a law effect, everything collapsed. The building of a society crushed. People started to ruin each other. Just imagine what will happen with our society if they broadcast over the radio. Well, tomorrow, from 15 hours through to 16 hours, the law will not be valid. Whatever anyone would do, he will not be subjected to punishment. In this country, in any European country, if freedom is given for an hour, what will happen? I don't know. There will be, I think, such a havoc that not any war could bring such a devastation. This is an indication of the inner contents of a person, his spiritual status. The world of non-Christian belief, non-religious world, what it is a state of spirit, that in a human being spirit is primarily not a body. By the way, such freedom that would set free instincts makes a man voluptuous and free person. Will sell any freedom for an opportunity of enjoyment. I liked one phrase from a book, Transfer, Kalinowski. That is about a life behind the coffin. A very good book. The phrase says, everywhere in the world, freedom is dying away. Do you hear? Everywhere they keep chanting about freedom, but, he writes clearly, everywhere in the world, if freedom dies away, political, economical, and personal, one could live easily without a freedom. That's correct. An animal lives more easily without freedom. More and more people give up freedom in exchange for comfortable and convenient life. No need to take decisions. Less responsibility. And look how it is reflected in the religious life. Do you know what 90% of people are searching a spiritual father for? Maybe 90%. Less responsibility. No need to take decisions. Father, from what side shall I get out of bed? And everything is settled. Such a misfortune. They search not spiritual edification, not ways of salvation, not good for internal life, but a man who will rule me, who will rule myself. I will rather give up my freedom, not only to make decisions and not to be responsible. Slavery, they search slavery. They search oracles, not spiritual fathers. This refusal from freedom is quite justified. Passions enslave a man. I've just read out the words from Apostle Peter's work. A man is a slave to whatever has mastered him. A man conquered by passions is a slave of these passions. I'd like to touch upon another important issue connected with the problem of freedom. The issue of religious freedom. First of all, I've already told you that if we consider church as a certain society and organization, we'll find nothing special about it. Well, it is natural for it to possess the same freedoms, rights, which are inherent in any other organization. But there are some specific features. The first thing what we should pay attention to is that in many countries, including our country, religious organizations, well, let's call them conditionally churches, they ask more freedoms for themselves than other organizations. One of the reasons behind it, church does not produce anything. In this aspect, it is not a certain commercial organization. Moreover, it satisfies the needs of spiritual requirements of a man. And consequently, it demands definite benefits as far as taxes are concerned, for example. A question arises. According to what principles should we judge whether this organization is a religious one? You know that some of them just use this religious form as a cover. They allege that they are religious, not being as such. In real fact, they are swindlers, people who found a lucky chance to enrich themselves, to exploit different people. Here we confront a serious issue, which is of interest not only from a Christian point of view, but from the civic, juridical point of view. What can be called a religious organization? How this issue can be solved? I believe the state must be concerned about solving this task. Along which way could it be solved? By way of discussing, considering, by investigating, by both sides, what kind of organization is this or that one? So the two sides, I mean, from the side of the state and from the side of religious experts, state and religious representatives. By doing it only, we can seriously come to understanding and agreement. That kind of society is this or that one, whether it is a religious one or not, and is it really in need of these benefits? And benefits are not financial only. There are some other kind of benefits, possibility to disseminate information, to enter mass media, and etc. This is one of the problems. Each time, theologians and lawyers together must evaluate a new phenomenon, which claims to be a religious one. The second side of the matter, moral evaluation of teachings of this religious doctrine, which is very important. We are now speaking about religious freedom. And, well, a well-known Ohm syndicate had a religious freedom, and they occupied such high positions. The activists were accepted at a very high level. What great religious freedom they possessed. And all that until they committed that terrorist act in Tokyo's underground. Then, in our country, they rushed to close the company. Why? What a shame. There they kill, and here we'll give them complete freedom. Imagine, we are speaking about religious freedom. And Satanists, for one, is it a religious organization? I believe what is needed here is an assessment from moral point of view. criterion of a moral order should be evaluated. On the basis of these, we can try and make our judgment about this society. That is, again, a very serious thing, because all swindlers, of course, hide the negative sides of their teaching. But you cannot hide an eel in a sack. That is the second problem, which is very important. But I do not know in which measure it is being solved. And there is a third problem, the most important and the most delicate problem. That is the problem of freedom and rights. So, and now you see, as I mentioned before, everything is intermingled. And here I pose the problem in such a perspective. Is it the same thing to speak about freedom and equal rights? Are they the same things? Or are these quite different things? I would assert that that is not a hollow question. It is worthwhile speaking about. Where is the difference between freedom and equality? Well, say, let's take a democratic country. Well, let's take any country. So everybody seems to have equal rights. They have equal rights, for example, to be elected somewhere. But we all understand that president has such great rights, which we do not have, of course. Moreover, if everyone is giving such rights, that means that would be the end of a state. No equality. Look, what rights has a general and what rights has a soldier? There is no equality and cannot be. Why then president possesses bigger rights than any other citizen? Due to one reason only. The majority voted for him. Which majority? 50% plus one. And right away, he has such rights that no one could have. Just think. But that is a democratic principle that lies in this very fact. Democracy. People's power. A solution is made depending on what it is considered a law and what is not. 50 plus 1. A law is adopted. 50 plus 1. A law is rejected. Do you understand? This is called a democratic principle. I would emphasize once again, the fact of granting greater rights depends on the majority. Or which majority would like to accept it. A very simple principle. In all parliaments, it is being solved in this way. Just in this way, decisions are taken. So it is not really important if it is 50% or two-thirds of votes. Just this is democracy. I'm speaking just about an idea. So from this point of view, let's look at equality of all religions. That is what we hear about now and then. Will it be fair that if a small religious group, which in fact a religious one, and has its own belief, its own teaching, possesses the same rights as a religion, communion with 3/4 of the population. Here, 3/4 of the population, and there, 3/4 of a man. Well, of course not. Quite obvious. If the majority of the population supports just that very organization, well, let's call it a church, so naturally it should have much bigger rights than that, for which only 1% of the population voted. Two candidates. One became president and got these great rights. The other one failed and has the rights that every person has, not more. Here it appears to be the same thing. Here there must exist a certain coefficient, a lawful coefficient. But even without a lawful coefficient, it is obvious that that very church that has a support from the overwhelming majority of the population, or just a majority of the population, should have more rights than the other. Isn't it fair? Well, no doubt, true. This is how it occurs in the West. Some churches in Europe possess primary rights. The other, that are many, do not possess them. As soon as we speak about Russia, all Western media go mad with rage. Why don't your religious minorities have the same rights as Russian church? Why isn't it a state-owned? And they pour down nonsense, whatever they want. Look, where are you from? Austria? Look how things are in your country. From Germany? Look how the whole thing is your country. France? Look, what are you speaking about? Well, you should remember that. So a democratic principle is based on an elementary principle of simple majority. I would rather cite another example. Just imagine some rich religious sect comes to a poor country where the overwhelming majority profess a single belief. Well, say, let's take Ethiopia. Well, according to a law that is in force in this country, the sect has equal rights in the press, in the television, in the mass media, as it has bought all of them, as the sect is very rich, and it starts propaganda against the religion of this population. On the one hand, yes, freedom of press, freedom of speech, why not? On the other hand, such a devil-like mockery on the principle of democracy. The majority of the population is against it, but a flood of propaganda is being poured from the screen. I believe if a referendum is to be held right now, probably the majority of the population would vote against this unbridledness, which we watch in commercials and in all other things, against that lack of morality, that dominance that takes place now. So some would express an opinion that they are for it, but the majority will vote against. I'm sure this is not done because invisible rulers pushing forward presidents, deputies, and etc. to their post would lose their power. Shadow figures. Where is democracy then? I do not understand. It is worth mentioning in this connection to recall that son John of Kronstadt condemned with an indignation the granting of freedoms to all religions, freedoms of equality, which was done by the last Tsar in 1905. But nobody wants to know that it is incorrect to condemn him. So I'd like to cite some words written by Illarion Troitsky. When the Tsar abdicated in February 1917 and church got its freedoms, local council opened at last, the highest resolution.
Он писал: «Высочайшая резолюция 31 марта 1905 года».
Of March 31st, 1905, on the report of the Holy Synod on Convention of Council, had the resolution of a Tsar. I admit it impossible to commit such a great deed in the time we are surviving now. I believe a council of all Russia Church is to be convened when more favorable times comes. Illarion Troitsky writes then, years passed after years, the status of Orthodox Church was becoming unbearable. Church life was getting into disarray. The formerly persecuted religious communions got freedom. Councils of religious dissenters had their sittings embedded in ancient Orthodox Moscow. Baptists convened their congress. However, a favorable year has not come yet for an Orthodox Church. The attitude of the Tsar dynasty to the Orthodox Church is a historic example of ingratitude. The Petersburg period of the Russian history is coming to an end when an awful disgrace and heavy nationwide calamity. General Kireev, a well-known general and a well-known theologist, monarchist, who firmly supported the idea that there should be a Tsar power in the country, not a kind of democracy, made such commentaries of freedom, giving reforms by Nicholas II. Tsar does not understand those deep changes which his laws on equality and belief introduced into our life. He mixed up freedom with equality. No one is against freedom, but equality and propaganda is quite a different thing. So I'd say even now we have to mention these things. Only yesterday I had a talk with a certain person. He was very much surprised. He said, "It has never occurred to me that equality and freedom are quite different things." Yes, really different. And that is another point that a special attention should be paid to. These are not the same things. These are different things. That could be useful information for you when you will give your answers to pro-Western critics who demand equal rights for all religious organizations functioning in our country.
Для всех религиозных организаций, которые находятся в нашей стране.
That would not be a democracy. A democracy that is solved by a majority. That would be some other principle. Which one? Absolutely clear. A principle which in Greece will be a principle of plutocracy. But it's better not to translate the first word. But if we do translate it, it will mean richness, Plutus, richness, Kratos, power, evidently. That is the very thing which they were driving at. It will be in all senses wrong if we give the same rights to both. That is another outstanding problem of our life. Huge congresses are convened to discuss the problem of freedoms, equality, and etc. Unfortunately, everything is so often so much intermingled that people are misled. They start speaking frankly. Well, we are to have the equal rights. Initially, each possesses equal rights to be elected, but after being elected, he gets special rights, which do not belong to anyone, and no one can possess these rights. If we want our society to be really stable, steadfast, and viable. So, what we are really speaking about, the rights which are granted to each religious organization have to be correlated by law with the degree of its recognition by the population. That is, by its democratic recognition, in which social truth is expressed and will be expressed. Do you see social truth? Where is it in actual implementation of the social principle, which is based on majority? In this case, only freedom and equality will not be in conflict with each other when they concern religious freedoms. Moreover, that would be the actual expression of God's love. Well, Mark Zealot said clearly, God, having given commandments on love, ordered to search God's truth, knowing that it is mother of love. Well, you see how the problem of justice and love are interconnected in social aspect. In social aspect, these problems are very rigidly linked up. It turns out that justifiable usage of the principle of democracy in part is a mother of love. Only on this principle it is possible to perform what we call love in its social expression. So, my friends, you see how the things look like. And one more remark. I'd like to remind to you Isaac Sirian wording.
Ибо никогда человек
не познает
силы Божьей в покое и
свободе. Will never come to know the power of God being at rest and in freedom. Do not be surprised when you approach virtue. Bitter cruel sorrows will flood on you from everywhere. Thus, virtue is not respected, which is not accompanied by a difficulty of the deed. St. John, the prophet, said, virtue usually confronts difficulties. It deserves reproach when it is tied up with a state of rest. You see, freedom, how Kant expressed the idea, freedom is being advocated by everyone. It is directed to search for his peacefulness. What I want, I do. And it turned out a man is incapable